Hello, everyone, and welcome back for the afternoon session of the 2016 Spring Teaching Effectiveness Institute. Our topic this afternoon is how we teach, connecting philosophy with practice, building on this morning's discussion of teaching philosophy, although not requiring attendance at this morning's session. With that, I am going to turn things over to Janet Giesen. So Janet Giesen is the Instructional Design Coordinator with Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center and will be your host and guide extraordinaire through the rest of this morning. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Stephanie, very much for that great introduction. As I mentioned, or as Stephanie mentioned, I am Janet Giesen. I've been in the Faculty Development for over 10 years now. I'll be facilitating today's afternoon session, which is entitled How We Teach, Connecting Philosophy with Practice. We have a few goals for this afternoon. And the first one is building on your teaching philosophy. And as Stephanie mentioned, you wouldn't have to have attended this morning's session to really understand what a philosophy is or even build one. But during this afternoon session with our presenters, we're hoping that you gain some insight and some ideas on how you can actually either prepare to create a teaching philosophy or build on one that's existing, or even review the one that you have and possibly make some changes. Another goal is, in essence, how you can align your teaching philosophy with your teaching practices. I think a lot of us go ahead and teach and we just kind of do it, maybe not necessarily on the fly, but maybe without a whole lot of deep consideration in what we're actually doing. So our presenters today will give you some pointers on how you can actually align a philosophy of teaching statement and the teaching practices that you are using for a particular class. Our schedule for this afternoon, at 1:30, we have a presentation on educational philosophy in general, kind of world views. Then we have several presentations based on some what we call isms. The first one is going to be on idealism. Then at 2:15, we have someone speaking on realism. Then we have a break. And then we have two more presentations with pragmatism and then existentialism. And then we'll conclude at 4 o'clock. So we've developed a few slides here that kind of illustrate the economic and environmental benefits of offering this institute online rather than being face-to-face. So the first one, based on the number of participants as of yesterday, total number of miles round trip that would have been driven by all of you had you driven to campus today. This is a pretty substantial number, 1,800 miles. And then the average number of miles round trip that would have been driven is 72.07 miles. And then we looked at the gasoline saved based on the stats that you see here. Assuming average miles per gallon 23.8 with a vehicle in 2012. So, you know, 79 gallons of gasoline was saved. And the cost of the gasoline based on, which is about right, $2 a gallon today, is $157. So you can see the economic value here. And then finally, we looked at the pounds of carbon dioxide emissions saved by everyone staying home today and not driving at least their car. We're not looking at lawnmowers and those types of things. So about 1,529 pounds. So that's kind of hard to visualize what that actually is. So if you think about four African lions, two male and two female, that equates to roughly 1,600 pounds. So that gives you kind of a nice visual to hang your hat on about the carbon emissions that were saved by staying home today. So during our afternoon presentations, feel free to ask questions. As Stephanie illustrated, you can use a chat feature, which is quite popular. You can raise your hand. But we do want you to ask questions and share comments that you might have. And we really do look forward to active participation. So you don't have to just sit there and just listen to us drone on. We really do welcome your insight, whether it's through chat, even emails later on. All right. I would like to now introduce our first presenter, Cameron Wills, who is a research associate here in Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center. And Cameron is going to be kind of setting the stage for this afternoon's sessions by talking more about the philosophy of education. Cameron, welcome.
Thank you, Janet. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the afternoon session of How We Teach, Connecting Philosophy with Practice. Please raise your hand if you are not in this morning session, just to kind of get a feel for who may be a newcomer. We got, let's see, one, two. You can leave your hand raised until we get a full count here. So a handful. The reason I ask is just like Janet said, you don't necessarily have to have attended the morning session, but the whole idea is for the afternoon session is to really connect the philosophies that we develop to practices that we take to the classroom. So the purpose in a way of this institute is to reflect on our practices, to realign our teaching and course objectives based off those philosophies, and then revising our practices, things we actually carry into the classroom accordingly. And so I kind of developed this 3R graphic here. One of the things that was a nice setup for this morning was it seemed to resonate with all of our morning presenters to revisit the teaching philosophy often, whether it be to revise it or to realign classroom practices or just to remember, why it is that we do what we do and trying to do that better. Continuing with the R theme that we have, we also want to reassure you in the practices that you are employing and then re-energize you. I know that it's somewhat of a, you look outside and it's a little gray, overcast. It's not really a get up and go at them sort of environment. So another reason we wanted to have this institute was to sort of reinvigorate us for the spring semester. So some of the philosophical themes we're going to discuss today, and this is very grossly speaking, are listed here. Just as a brief, and then I mean very, very brief overview. idealism, kind of dealing with pursuing the big T truths, abstract ideals. Realism, finding material truths in the world, more concrete realities. Pragmatism, coming from the view that reality is contextual, socially driven. And then finally, existentialism, the view that reality is more subjective to the individual. And so depending on which approach we take, these themes will shape how we teach. And so the practices will be more aligned with idealism, realism, pragmatism, existentialism may be distinct, have distinct differences. So note that our presenters are not, in fact, advocating for one approach over another, nor do they necessarily align themselves with one over another. It's really just to give you an idea, grossly, of these philosophical themes and really focus more on what are the practical, pragmatic things that we can derive from their philosophical underpinnings. So again, our goal is to introduce you to basic tenets and provide you with those applications or exercises that you may consider using in your own classroom or in your course design. So again, there's no right or wrong approach. For our purpose, it should not be considered exclusive. If you're very, very deep in the philosophy, you may find things to be incompatible with one another, but for our purposes, we should not consider them necessarily exclusive. So if you find something that resonates you with idealism and pragmatism, don't think that you have to choose one or another. Really follow whatever resonates with you, reflect on any existing ideas you have, and then consider other points of view that maybe you hadn't considered as part of your teaching philosophy or your practice. So again, the question for this afternoon is, why do we want to connect our philosophy with practice? It makes sense that we try to live out what we believe. This is true in our daily lives, and it should be true in our classrooms as well. So practicing what we preach is sort of what we're trying to orient around. Asking ourselves, what do we really believe about education? How is education, how should education be done? How is it done well? And then asking more personally, how is this evident in my class? Oftentimes, if we don't reflect on our practice and what we're doing, we fall into routines which may not align with what we really believe to be true or right about education or even our discipline. So again, our hope this afternoon is to call to mind what you believe constitutes good education, particularly in your field, and how or what you can do as a teacher, or what you do as a teacher can be more reflective of those teaching philosophies. So just as a graphic here for how we find some of our practices may be more or less in alignment. There are a couple different elements of class which may or may not be more or less aligned with what you believe or your philosophy. So again, asking the question, how does your teaching align with your philosophy? With this, consider things like assessment, course design, how discussion and dialogue is handled in the classroom, calling to mind these practices and how well they fit what your philosophical beliefs are, and how this might look under perhaps different philosophical approaches that we covered this afternoon. So things that maybe you don't necessarily adhere to, but at least be curious about how that might look under another philosophical point of view. So some of the benefits that we hope that you will derive from this is to more thoroughly believe in what you're doing, to continue to develop an ideal practice in teaching, to engage your students at a deeper level, more meaningful level with your subject. And then also increase credibility with students. Students recognize you're being authentic with them, that you're not sort of that you're passionate about what you're doing, and that your practices in the classroom, your course design, et cetera, all of that. And it's not just a bunch of hot air. As far as change management, certainly don't be discouraged if you can't have the ideal classroom tomorrow. Some changes you may want to implement right away from this afternoon, some may take longer. The goal overall is really just to move towards greater alignment. So doing what you can, the small changes which can be put into practice immediately may help change the direction and that you're taking with your class and start setting the tone for what you want to create in the future. Large changes can usually will take longer, perhaps many semesters, but you and your class will benefit in the long term. In any case, don't be discouraged. Again, doing what we can and planning for how we can create our ideal practice as educators. So again, the graphic of the key being to reflect on the practice, to realign our teaching with our course objectives and to revise our practices accordingly. Repeat these steps often, and especially at the start of a new semester as we go forward. So this is the basic format for this afternoon's session. In general, just giving an expectation of what's to come. Each presenter will go over a brief introduction to the philosophical theme. They'll cover commonalities in those themes, review sample teaching philosophies that are more oriented with whatever that vein may be, and then review examples and practice. And then the most important part, you, the audience, coming on, giving the examples and leading the discussion about ideas oriented around the philosophy. So finally, my last slide here, as you go through each session, try to keep notes on which elements of practice that you may want to employ based off the physical under or the philosophical underpinnings that resonate most with you. Consider your teaching philosophy and think of ways to tweak or transform your classroom as appropriate. So thank you all once again for attending. I really look forward to seeing what comes out of this afternoon's sessions. Thank you.
Thank you, Cameron, for that insight on what's happening today or this afternoon.
Testing.
I'd like to now introduce our first themed presenter is Dan Cabrera, who's our multimedia coordinator here in Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center. Dan?
Thank you, Janet. Just want to make sure that everyone can hear me. Yes, thank you so much. All right, I'd like to emphasize, and maybe this serves as warning for the my colleagues who will follow, that our discussion of the isms today, I'll start off with idealism, is not meant to be comprehensive in any way. We just have half an hour to discuss, so we're really just hitting the highlights of our particular educational philosophy. So there is a lot more to each one of our presentations that could be focused on if we had 3 hours or a semester to talk about that. So I'm going to start off a presentation just by giving that caveat about our discussion. So I am talking about idealism. When we talk about idealism, we're talking about a very, very old concept. In fact, it's considered, if I'm going to define it, it's considered the oldest systematic philosophy in Western culture. And Plato, the philosopher, was the founder of idealism. In fact, he's considered a leading contributor to philosophy of the Western world. And for those who were at this morning's session, Carrie Birch was talking about what philosophy is. It is, in fact, the love of wisdom. Plato's ideas about education has enabled us to analyze and to rethink issues with education today. In fact, Plato's goals was to help individuals see past appearances in the physical, and he wanted to have his students examine what's underlying the meaning or concepts and ideas of the physical. Plato's presentation of philosophical works in the form of dialogues gave the world's philosophy the philosophy. In fact, Plato took Socrates' maxim, virtue is knowledge, and extrapolated it into an elaborate theory of knowledge, which envisioned a level of reality beyond that immediately available to the senses, but accessible to reason and intellect. The students of Plato's Academy, the first school of philosophy in Athens, were to go beyond the concrete world of perception and come to understand the universal ideas or forms which represent a higher level of reality. Plato's idealism extended to the concept of an ideal state as outlined in his Republic. This was a state ruled by intellectual elite of philosopher kings. So idealism really stresses the importance of learning ideas and concepts. Indeed, ideas are, according to idealists, the only true reality, the only things worth knowing. They believe in reasoning, but question the use of scientific method and sense perception. They have the most confidence in ideas that remain constant through time and place. When it comes to teaching students, idealists believe in sharing ideas and great works that are universal, as well as long-lived, or who stand the test of time. They believe that all students should have at least one teacher that they look up to, so that they can learn cultural norms. In the classroom, idealists put a lot of focus on lectures, discussion, and imitation. Since truth is perfect and eternal, it can't be found in the world of matter that is both imperfect and constantly changing. What is ultimately real is not the material world or the material object itself, but the ideas behind it. So material things do not exist according to idealists, independent, but are only a construction in the mind of the human being. The material world is characterized by change, instability, and uncertainty. While some ideas are enduring, these ideas, values, are absolute and unchanging. For instance, improvement of the human condition. Morality is necessary. War is irrational. The need for universal ethics. In other words, idealism emphasizes what the world could be rather than what the world currently is. The individual person can realize value by actively relating parts and wholes. People do not create knowledge, but rather they discover it. Actually, this is from the Doctrine of Reminiscence. It's a theory that was propounded by Greek philosopher Plato, which states that all knowledge must originate in a hypothetical existence before birth, whereas humans attain knowledge of the true forms of essences of the material world. This knowledge is accessed after birth with mental processes of recollection and reminiscence. Plato posited that this hypothetical existence was the only way for humans to have knowledge of certain concepts, like perfect equality, which cannot be gleaned from experience. So I'd like for you to consider the following. Say, for instance, if I respond to any of these characteristics or attributes, I might consider myself an idealist. So I could be an idealist if I view teaching as a calling, something very noble. I see the teacher as an exemplary role model. I could be an idealist if I engage in Socratic questioning, if I value the use of dialectic or critical discussion. Continuing, I could also be an idealist if I foster character development as an outgrowth of thinking and thoughtful actions. I stress the importance of self-realization, and self-realization is just knowledge of the self. And that I value a comprehensive, systematic, and holistic approach to education. So idealists firmly hold that curriculum should be concerned with the whole humanity and its experience. Here I've got an image with a quote from Helen Keller. Never bend your head, always hold it high. Look the world straight in the eye. So let's look at some of the educational aims from the perspective of the idealism school of philosophy. One of the chief aims is to develop the mind, or the ability to think. This is conscious reasoning of the mind. And although idealists believe that the mind, which can conceptualize, create, and can accumulate facts, it needs to be nourished and developed. And there needs to be a search for true ideas or truths, aesthetic or beauty. So character development is also an important component of education, an aim of education. It is the promotion of goodwill and loyalty, for instance. It is wisdom, moral conviction. The aims of education really is the promotion of moral values, and it gives prime importance to subjects like literature, history, music, and poetry, together with other humanities, and secondary place to scientific subjects. It focuses really on imitating examples of noble characters in history and heroes. And as I mentioned previously, self-realization is also an important aim, which is the full knowledge of the self. Another aim of education is to preserve and transmit culture. It is to teach ideas that are everlasting. It is to seek enduring truths which are constant and not changing through the things that I just mentioned before, like great literature, art, and philosophy. It, in fact, is to discover an individual's, to develop an individual's abilities and full moral excellence in order to better serve society. I think it was interesting this morning when Stephanie was asking people about what is the purpose of their, they as teachers, their impact on students. And although some people said it was important for people to learn skills and expertise in certain areas, there was also the recognition that individuals need to be fully developed. They need to have a rounded education to understand more than just facts, to really have an understanding of how one learns and how one thinks and believes in a moral way. It's important to recognize that from this perspective, the teacher is an exemplary role model. I think, we all intuitively or intrinsically recognize the importance of representing this exemplary role model. And the shock to society when you have a story, usually in the news, of a teacher who has violated that trust, and how damaging it is, not just between the teacher and a particular student, but between that teacher and all of society, because it loses faith in the veracity of what should be an honorable profession. So a teacher, as part of that exemplary role model, should be doing things to encourage students to ask important questions, to provide a suitable environment for learning. So setting up the context by providing credible, valid, useful source material, and that could be in the form of lectures or carefully vetted textbooks and articles that actually provide students an opportunity to learn a lot. And also to provide learning activities, to provide assignments that really get the most out of their students. They can assist their students in choosing important materials to that end. And they should be infusing students with a desire to improve their thinking. And I think that was one of the main points this morning of Carrie Birch's presentation, which really was not just to have students be a deposit or a bank account for facts, where we as the instructors provide this information, provide facts, provide data for students to regurgitate, but also to teach them with a desire to learn not just more facts, but learn truths and be able to become critical thinkers in that endeavor. Some of the techniques of idealism, but I should emphasize that this doesn't say that only idealists use these techniques, these are techniques that idealists had been known to use, is the development of Socratic characteristics, such as analyzing, discussing with others. Discussion is a very, very important component of idealism, to encourage students to think, to improve their thinking. It emphasizes concepts, important big concepts, over specific facts. And in fact, it uses lectures to stimulate thought, not just to convey information. So once again, we're not just talking about a deposit, a bank account, where we're depositing, as the instructors are depositing information. We're really utilizing materials, or we should be utilizing materials, in ways that promote, enhance, encourage critical thinking with their students. So it's not simply that students will remember things that they've been taught in my class, facts that they've been taught in my class, and they may remember it in the next semester, they may remember it in the next year, but in 5 years they may not remember specific facts. However, it's important that they leave with an improved sense of who they are and an ability to critically evaluate the world, critical in the sense of being able to decipher what is accurate, what is correct, what is truthful. And so the focus, at least in the courses, is on reading and writing. And in fact, what we're talking about is providing access to reading materials that foster the discussion of big ideas, not small, trivial ideas. It's also about writing and emphasizing both personal expression and clear reasoning. And of course, we'd have to demonstrate how to do that, clear reasoning. So I'm going to talk a little bit about, I'll give an example of what and I guess this is the first example of our four different philosophies, what a teaching philosophy from an idealism perspective might appear like. So here's what it might sound like. Students will be challenged to think in ways that may be new to them, uncomfortable even. Rather than just adding more facts and material to the repertoire of knowledge, they will be encouraged to think more critically by reading, listening, reflecting, responding to questions, and most importantly, discussing. And so to that end, when we talk about having some techniques or methods for instruction, all of these things really need to be a part of that discussion. So what are some of these teaching methods that idealists use? And once again, I'm saying that that other perspectives use these as well. These are just things that idealists have been known to use. Well, primarily it's oral methods, and that could be in the form of lectures, discussion, and dialogue. Now, dialectic and dialogue really come from the Greek word for conversation. The dialogue was a literary genre. It's invented by the followers of Socrates. And it was to give written representation of dialectic, his conversational style of philosophical reasoning. The style of reasoning really requires two people, the questioner and the respondent. The questioner gets the respondent to assert something. The questioner then tests this assertion by putting the respondent through a series of questions. The questioner's hope is that in answering these questions, the respondent will be led to deny the initial assertion. Now, if so, then the respondent is refuted. However, if not, then the initial assertion can stand, at least for the moment. One obvious beauty of dialectic is that the questioner need not claim any expertise in the subject of the conversation. In fact, this made the role of questioner ideal for Socrates, who liked to say that his wisdom consisted simply of not knowing in knowing what he did not know, well, that he didn't know very much.
So I had mentioned an alternative or an additional teaching methodology, which is the use of reading, writing, and self-directed learning. And I started talking about how it's important for instructors, for faculty, for teachers, to allow students to find their own sources, to evaluate and to reflect on those sources. It's important to learn you know, who to follow or engage with, because as the instructor, you can bring this information to students who may not have the experience, so you have a very important role to play in terms of identifying what valid sources are and why they're valid. In fact, what you are responsible is to support the growth of students. Ultimately, do you want to challenge them? Do you want to push them to be better? You want to push them to grow. And through the use of these techniques, you can do that. So let's talk about what some examples of applying this might like. And I should mention that while critical thinking encompasses many components, in general it refers to the ability to think effectively about a subject, to properly understand and evaluate material, and to make reasonable decisions. So that people who think critically have the ability to ask appropriate questions, to gather relevant information, to sort efficiently and creatively through information, and reason logically with it, and come to reliable and trustworthy conclusions about the material, problem, or situation in question. This is according to Van Gelder. So how can we help our students learn? Let's see. That's right, Isabel. How can we help our students learn and or improve the critical thinking skills? Well, we have to give them some activities or that truly engage them. And so the first suggestion is to assign persuasive essays or articles and other reading materials that really force students to evaluate the forms of material so that they can actually critically analyze that and be able to respond to questions that you may ask them about that material. So that's not really a quick read-through or a perusal, but actually taking the articles apart, really making it more meaningful. Another example is in writing. We may, as instructors, choose to assign written responses to assigned reading materials in which questions must be answered, logical reasonings and analytical understandings demonstrated, and reasonable conclusions drawn. So they're going to have to be able to demonstrate that to our satisfaction. Another example is the use of discussions. And in discussions, we can, for example, provide a subject-oriented debate in the form of students, where they may openly discuss and recognize various arguments and then judge the credibility of course materials, point out the logical fallacies, and then talk about how to transfer the information to other situations. So this is not just a roundabout, you know, what do you think of the material, but actually really breaking it down, really completely understanding it. Now I'm going to ask you for some possible examples from your own courses that you might use, you might have used, that are similar to what we've discussed already, instructional activities, assignments, or how you assess your students. I actually would like to start off myself with an example. I teach a course in ethics, ethical decision making for healthcare professionals. And in the first session, in order to get them to buy into the course material, I show them a video. This is from PBS. I think Ethics in America is a series. And Arthur Miller, who's a Harvard law professor, actually is engaged in this discussion or dialectic. And in fact, what's happening is that we have maybe about 10 individuals, each one of these in the audience, and each one of these individuals is a leader in their own field. For instance, we have a person who is the editor of Journal of American Medical Association. We have another one who is the director of the National Institute of Health. We have a Supreme Court justice. So we have people who are at the highest level of their particular profession. And Arthur Miller starts the discussion with a case study in which he presents something which may seem easy to respond to. But as he starts to develop the facts of a particular case, he starts to make some minor changes. And these minor changes really make a world of difference. So it's not simply an understanding of what is right and wrong. In fact, an ethical dilemma is something which provides you an opportunity to have to act in different directions, in equally compelling ways. So it's not easy to say this is clearly the right way or this is clearly the wrong way. I usually show that in the last half hour of the first class, and the session is the movie actually is an hour long. I have, to this date, never had a class who only wanted to see half an hour. Usually they stay half an hour beyond the time because it's so engaging and it really sets a framework for the rest of the semester for the students. They really want to find out how to do this stuff. And so, we work on a systematic framework for engaging in ethical decision making. So I'd like to ask now for others if they've had any examples of instructional activities or assignments that they've given that really reflect this desire to focus on ideas, on concepts, on noble ideas. Okay, so I'm going to look over in the chat area. Okay. Thank you so much, Jen. So Jan Reynolds also said we have to create a safe environment. And this is really critical. If the student really feels that they're in competition with their faculty member, instead of being supported by their faculty member, they're not likely to buy into, to what it is you want to do. You ultimately want to change the way people think and think in new ways that are healthy and that will leave them far better at the end of the semester than at the beginning of the semester. Okay, so Jan said, I ask students to write journal entries that I only grade for content and ideas. I respond with questions rather than corrections. Excellent example. Thank you so much. Okay. Let's see, Yvonne. Let's see. Let's see. So Tracy says that we also have to appreciate and celebrate the learning that comes with failure. Too often we view success as a measurement of learning rather than the number of learning opportunities engaged from failure. Absolutely. If students become afraid to try because they're afraid of failure, then of course you're going to have the opposite effect. You're going to be stifling or censoring their thought process when in fact they should in fact explore. They should try things that stretch them. Mary Elaine Corin says, I have students critique research articles in a group. Absolutely think this is a fabulous idea because I, in fact, have group activities. Now, anyone who's taught for any length of time knows that students almost universally do not like group activities for a variety of reasons. And a big part of that is they think that somebody else is going to be a slacker, that they'll have to pick up and do more work than is necessary. And there really is an equity between individuals. One of the things that I like to do is I like to work with my students to teach them about group dynamic, teach them about role responsibilities and the sense of obligation that each person has to each other, and also the power or the resource that each person represents to their teammates, and how everyone can benefit. Plus, you know, there's that synergy of when people are exchanging ideas. If you only have one person with an idea, okay, you can only go so far. But if you have two people with different ideas, then they actually might end up with more than the one idea, or an idea that is greatly enhanced. I absolutely like group activity, and group discussion is really the center point for that, because if you have people talking with each other, if you open up the line of communication and they can discuss and they feel comfortable and responsible, and actually from my perspective, I like to provide support in terms of monitoring that activity. I don't have to worry about the students falling through the cracks and not participating, and I find out in week 14 that they haven't been participating, and so I get them to have a weekly status report, see how they're doing. Okay. Other examples? Okay. Such as what type of assignments that you give. For instance, I'd mentioned the group assignment. And actually, it is creating a case study. They've, you know, by the time they're doing this, they would have had a lot of experience looking at other case studies, and they'll be asked to construct a case study and then conduct the ethical analysis, you know, so they really leave feeling very comfortable about how to do this. Okay, no other examples. All right, so what I want to do is at this point is point out that I do have references here. Idealism in the philosophy of education, idealism in the aims of education, and idealism and education. And lastly, this great article that I had, Improving College-Level Critical Thinking Skills. This is from Sarah Rathburn from Colorado State University. Okay. Oh, I feel I have some input from Stephanie Ur. I have my nursing students participate in healthcare topic debate, and they work in a group. Fantastic. My background actually is in public health, and from some of the projects that I worked in, I found that public health nurses are remarkable in that they are in the first line of defense for the best of society or to improve society. The idea that you have individuals who really are focused on helping others. And in fact, I had mentioned earlier on in the discussion of, you know, what the purpose of idealism is really is to better serve society or make society a better place. And I absolutely would say that nursing students discussing healthcare topics and debating them is actually working in a very good place. Let's see, the group members abide by group contracts, and it helps to alleviate the group fears to some degree. Fantastic. Great. Okay, thank you so much. Stephanie says, I put my students in the role of questioner in my courses by asking that they supportively ask each other questions during presentations, and they really get involved in digging deeper. And I think this is a good way to put it. Sometimes you have people who are just want to make their fellow students look bad. In this case, it absolutely appears that it's to improve to improve each other, and it'll get people to think more deeply and get them to reflect on what they're doing.
Thanks, Dan. Appreciate your great insight on your ism. Our next presenter is Tracy Miller. And Tracy is our online teaching coordinator here in Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center at NIU. Tracy?
Hi, thank you so much, Janet. Just a quick audio check. Can everyone hear me okay? Already sounds good. Okay, well, the ism I am going to talk about today is realism. And especially listening to Dan's presentation, I realize how These are definitely different schools of thought, but I think it's still something that we're probably going to pick and choose different beliefs and different philosophies and sort of blend them and make them into their own. But to begin, I'm going to talk a little bit about what is realism. So in the simplest of terms, it's the belief that reality exists independent of the human mind. And so with idealism, you know, it was all about the human mind. And realism is very different. It definitely talks about the material or physical truths of things. One of the things that it always makes me think of is that old story about if a tree falls in a forest and no one is around to hear it, does it make a sound? Now, I think idealists might think that nobody was there. But really, this philosophy is all about, you know, the physical truths. It's all about learning, about finding those absolute truths. And a lot of times that's through experimentation. And it's things that happen through observation or knowledge of reality. So the weather is actually quite pleasant today, I think, from what we were expecting. But, you know, finding a truth might be something like, you know, H2O will always freeze at 32 degrees Fahrenheit. And so that's an absolute truth, you know, that's not going to change based on any sort of human perception. So realism is considered convergent thinking. This is the ability to give the correct answer to questions that do not require significant creativity. And strangely enough, idealism is also considered convergent thinking because whether it's a school of thought or you know, an accepted principle in a discipline, you know, students are meant to converge their thinking into one correct answer. But in this case, realism is often used in the fields of science and math, lots of looking for those absolute truths in those disciplines. But I hope we can explore some other disciplines that might use this philosophy also. And then finally, it's an authoritarian philosophy, which means it is definitely more faculty-centered. Now, what does that look like? So I kind of pulled this apart in a couple different ways. And the first one was, okay, if we're teaching in a realism classroom, what is the realist teacher's role and what is that going to look like? So the first thing is that a realist teacher is considered the organizer and the presenter of content. And so they are that authority that is going to be creating those conditions for their students, in which case they will be able to consume that content. And then they're also going to be experts in their field. And this is another similarity to idealism. Again, they're that expert, that their authority in that field. And that's sort of that teacher role in that kind of classroom. Also, in a realism classroom, students are often motivated by some sort of behaviorism, if you kind of pull out a learning theory from this. And what happens there is that the teacher is going to stimulate students and motivate them to learn through some sort of reward system. And again, it's not an absolute. We're just sharing ideas on some of the things that we kind of teased out in our research about this philosophy. But it's kind of nice to kind of break it down and separate it and then kind of pull the pieces all back together again. And then finally, the realist teacher definitely wants to provide their students with opportunities to observe and imitate various different things that they want students to know or to be able to do. So if I go back to my tree example, you know, they want to be out there in the forest watching a tree fall down so the students observe that it actually does make a sound. So if that's what's going on from the teacher's side of things, what is happening? How do we know that learning is happening? And what a realist will tell you is that students learn best from others. And they do this from listening to you, or perhaps even listening to other experts. They may be reading a textbook or empirical research. And they also may be doing this through watching a certain phenomenon. And it's interesting, the word phenomenon, right? So we're not necessarily watching an eclipse. We may just be watching that tree falling in the forest. But that's the way that realists believe that students learn the best. And they're going to do this as they learn. They're going to be able to begin to master facts or basic skills. And they are trained to learn these facts or demonstrate these skills in order to be able to quickly recall these facts in order to make more informed decisions. So, you know, you're going to learn how to do some basic multiplication so that you can then build on using that in different applications. That's something definitely that that realists believe in. And they are there to find and discover answers through observation and experimentation. We definitely are going to talk more about examples more thoroughly in just a little bit. But the example that comes to mind here would be in the culinary arts. And so, you know, you can definitely, as a professor in the culinary arts, you're going to demonstrate a certain skill or maybe even talk about a certain technique, and then you're going to have the students master that skill by practicing over and over again until they are proficient or they master that skill. Okay, so I'm going to share what I came up with as a realism teaching philosophy. This is not meant for you to just copy and paste and put into your own, but just to give you an idea of what a teaching philosophy might look like if you were really zoned in on being a realist. So as your professor and expert in a field, I am responsible for organizing and presenting content in a way that will allow you to learn all the basic facts and master the necessary skills to be successful in this class. Hard work and practice are rewarded in my courses if you follow the procedures and processes as directed. This course is hands-on. You will have opportunities to demonstrate real phenomenon with precision and accuracy. And I think this kind of highlights all the points that I brought up at the beginning about, you know, what is realism. But I wanted to draw your attention to the fact that my graphic is a crossword puzzle. And I sort of used this crossword puzzle as a metaphor. And what I wanted to show was that this crossword actually includes some key terms typically associated with realism. But the crossword puzzle itself represents finding one absolute truth. So there's only one way you can fill in this crossword puzzle. And of course, there was questions behind it. But again, there was, you know, only one possible answer that would make this all fit together. So hopefully, when you're going back and you're thinking about, okay, what was Tracy talking about realism? You know, the crossword puzzle will jump into your head and you'll think about what it all means and how what it means to you, really. So realism in practice, because that's what we're talking about this afternoon. We're not being philosophical that much. We're talking about, okay, this all sounds, but how can I bring this into my teaching practice? How can I bring it into my classroom? And like Cameron talked about, how can I really be my authentic self? And so if you've been to our faculty development programs before. We love our learning objectives, and we also really advise to start off with students will be able to. And so what I did was I started with that students will be able to, and I pulled out some action verbs from Bloom's taxonomy, and I thought these action verbs really resonate with the realistic classroom. And so students will be able to locate, select, translate. If you're finding that some of your learning objectives are sort of being written that way, then maybe you're already leaning towards sort of a more realist classroom. And sometimes realism, because it's so much about facts, basic skills, that we think, okay, you know, how do we bring this to higher level? And I think there are ways that we can do this. So I'd like you to just stop and think a minute about these higher level action verbs I throw out here. Students will be able to solve, illustrate, reconstruct. These are things that when we talked about that students are going to be able to quickly recall some basic facts and be able to use them in an informed way for high level decision making. These are some of the things that you may see in a realist classroom. Now, I broke it down into these different categories so that you could, again, really practically think about how this might look in a classroom that has these realistic beliefs. And in one way, your content may say really simple things like, you will read this chapter. Now you may not say it, but you may lecture, so you want them to watch and listen to you. Maybe they're going to watch and listen to something else. I'm the online teaching coordinator, so I always think about it from sort of the online perspective, but you know, you can definitely consider your lecture as being part of their realistic classroom. Janet said, and the doing verbs are observable by the teacher. Yes, absolutely. That's why we love our action verbs here. Thank you, Janet. Review similar data. Realism is very evidence-based. And so we may ask students to review some other data in order to make, again, that informed decision. Learning activities we may ask them to do. Conduct procedures. Definitely the scientific method is heavily used in a realistic classroom at some level, I would say. We're going to have them practicing skills, even a practice lesson where it's something that they're going to practice and then maybe later on it will actually become an assessment. And again, observing that phenomenon. That could be anything from doing some field work, to even observing behavior, perhaps. And assessments, lab reports, multiple choice quizzes, great for that, letting us know about the quick recall, and then any kind of demonstration or resuscitation. I can never say that word. I wrote it out for myself phonetically and I still can't say it. Which is really going which is going to make this next slide horrible, because my first example is recitation. Yes, I said it. So what might happen? And I have a scratchy voice because I'm getting over this cold. So hopefully I'm not coming over too nasally. For the first example, you know, so what's going to happen? Teacher is going to deliver the content, you know, definitely an interesting and engaging way. And then the students are going to have to really actively participate in their learning. So whatever that study skill is that they need to do to remember and recall those basic facts or skills, you know, that's something that they're going to have to engage in. But it is more faculty-centered, so the faculty is definitely directing that in some ways. And then we're going to pull in that behaviorism again, and teachers might be extrinsically motivating their students to encourage learning. So what I've used at the bottom of the page here is some electronic badges. So if you're not familiar with these, I'll give you the 30-second elevator speech on them. But they are sort of a newer way of recognizing and rewarding students for achieving different skills, different levels, different parts of a procedure. Definitely a behaviorism trait right there. And in this case, I've just pulled one out for a research project. And research projects can be used in a variety of disciplines. There tends to be a procedure and involved. These are sort of the most common steps that you might take in a research project. And then the students can move their way through and receive badges for completing each task. My next example is a practicum. Thank you for sharing information about badges, Stephanie. I know that's kind of a side project for you that you have a great interest in. Cameron also. So in the case of a practicum, a teacher would provide instructions and demonstrate a skill. I talked a little bit about how that might work for the culinary arts. But then the students would practice and refine until they've mastered an intended skill. One of the examples I thought for this particular example, especially when students are observing and imitating others, would be in world languages, where students are learning new vocabulary or maybe improving their oral skills. Definitely something that is beneficial for students to be able to continue to be observe and refine until, again, they became proficient or mastered a skill in something. I also think this is a great activity, and I know we have a bunch of folks out there from nursing and other health sciences. This would be something that students would do, for instance, to learn how to take blood pressure or on how to administer an injection. Hopefully they're practicing that, mastering that before we let them move on to something else. Okay, I am pausing for a moment. I took a drink of water, but I also wanted to be able to give folks a chance to put things into the text chat area or even to raise their hands if you have some thoughts on the way realism is used in the classroom. Joyce said this also works in counseling. Pairing students to practice specific helping skills also allows them to experience the vulnerability of client relationship. I love your input, Joyce, that I had not thought about it in counseling, but there are those definite techniques, and you want to give the students, you know, chances to observe those techniques and then definitely to practice them themselves. And I think that's that may be definitely beyond a basic skill. You know, I'm sure that takes quite a bit of practice and experience. Any other examples of the way you've used a practicum and or with your students? Please feel free to share and add things to the text chat area. Jan says, I think realism has a role, and when we use it, it can be helpful to tell students that this approach is being taken because these facts/skills are necessary to have. You are so right about that. I think it's important that we tell students the purpose of what they are doing and why this will be helpful to them in the future. My example earlier of talking about, you know, even just the key terms of normally associated with realism, you know, why do we need to know these vocabulary words? And it's, again, it's that quick recall in order to be able to expand our minds, but it's not always so obvious when we don't explain it to our students. Janet said, it would be nice if all students to experience a practicum that they would allow them to practice what they have learned in real world situations. Absolutely. And that that's one of the things that I think would be great when I reflect on my teaching. You know, I always think, how can I bring this into the real world? And, you know, again, allow the students to have that safe environment, though, that we talked a little bit with Dan and even Cameron's presentation, that safe environment, would they realize that they could fail a little bit and learn and rebuild? Which is what I think you mean by maybe easier said than done, Janet. Okay, and my third example is directed inquiry. Inquiry is something that I've lived with for many, many years, 10 years or more at this point. I'm definitely more comfortable with some more open-ended type of inquiry, but there is definitely a place for a directed inquiry experience. And in this case, I'm kind of pulling over my examples of, you know, something that you might use in nursing. And this particular screenshot here is one I found, and I'm sure that the nursing folks will call me out if this is a completely bogus flow chart, but I just like the idea that it kind of can walk somebody through how to go and diagnose a patient with a migraine and what to do about it. And so this is something that a teacher may present to the students and walk them through this inquiry in that, again, that very faculty-centered way, kind of pointing out the steps to them as they go along. But typically what will happen is that the teacher will pose a question to the students, and then they'll get specific instructions or perhaps even a known formula to discover the answer. When I talk about known formulas, it always makes me think about mathematics. You know, you're always using that formula to discover different answers, and that's where sort of number three comes into play, where the students would be able to work a problem. And then, you know, the most important part, though, is that the teacher changes the variables, and that'll allow the students to not only practice this sort of directed inquiry in this very controlled environment, but it will also be able to be something that they'll be able to use going forward and predict future applications. I'm going to turn the mic off for a second. I got a cough. Okay, I kept you all from that. I guess it's another benefit of doing an online workshop. We're not all sharing germs. How many of you have used, I want to share Stephanie's thought first. She's used this when she's taught math. We work on simple problems, then they are applied to what they learn to slightly different problems. And thank you also for your support, Jason, and my coughing. So I'd like to hear more, though, about folks and what they've used for directed inquiry projects, sort of as I've outlined it here. We often have many different ideas of what it means to have a directed inquiry. As you're maybe thinking through some of your ideas, I'll share a couple that I've had. I think that when we work with students in computer science and we're teaching them how to write code, you know, we're giving them the right language, the right syntax they need to put the code together. But until they actually sort of write the code and kind of run the program, they're not sure what they're going to come up with, but they're definitely going to get some answers one way or the other. The other thing that I was sort of thinking about is in business, applying financial formulas, or even having students figure how different interest rates will affect anything from the way you invest money to what your mortgage payment is going to be like. And, you know, giving the students those basic facts and giving them those skills is something that they are hopefully going to really integrate and be able to use over and over again. And going back to what Jan said, giving them that purpose of why we're sharing that with them might help them understand where it will go from there. Okay, so we're going to have some fun with the whiteboard again. And so in this case, I really do want to hear some more of your examples. I am not necessarily putting it in any sort of box like I was asking for in my specific examples that I shared. But I have just put some column headers up there. So if you want to think about things as far as how do you share content, again, think about it in the way that in a realist classroom, it's definitely the faculty's role to share and organize content. We're definitely trying to bring them to that convergent thinking where they're finding those absolute physical or material truths. Activity, what are we asking the students to do in order to reinforce and to build that content information that we're giving them, and then assessing them? How are we going to know that that they're actually there? Okay, I'm seeing some already. Using guest experts to present unique topics or other instructional materials. Guest experts are a great idea. I even think it's sort of a maybe a more modern twist because we're all starting to realize we're not the only expert voice that they can listen to, especially in this world where we're all so connected. An activity, thoughtfully assign homework problems with specific variables. Excellent example. A group quiz. Wow, that would be awesome. Grading the process as well as the outcome. You know, I don't know who wrote that, but I absolutely love that because that goes back to that learning about how to learn. Yeah, we're getting check marks, lots of positive reinforcement on that one. By the way, that's behaviorism. We're reinforcing your great content by giving it check marks and underlining it. Giving examples of the lesson objectives. Okay, so maybe providing them with other examples. So that is pretty much giving them that absolute truth. Present material and then pause to create memory cues. How interesting. Museum visit, I'm seeing definitely observing a phenomenon in a museum. Also a simulation. Yes, maybe a simulation is not that real, but it's close. We're trying to get them to observe something. And we're seeing connection here. So first, we discuss the content. Then we have an activity of a simulation. Sorry, cough came out of here. And then finally, we assess it in a clinical setting. Yes, the simulation would be especially important if there was a safety risk where we definitely wanted them to practice more so before we kind of threw them out there in the field. So I see there is a connection between grade process as well as the outcome. So maybe we're going to go back and learn from something from the assessment and bring it back into a new activity. For those of you that weren't with us this morning, we found that not only have we attracted a very proficient group of whiteboard experts, but they've exceeded our expectations with their ability to make connections and give us verbal visual clues here. I see a connection between presenting materials and then pause to create the memory cues with design community outreach presentations of materials from class. Yes, so they're using the materials to create presentations. Awesome. Mary would like to know how you assess process. So whoever actually shared that, if you could maybe open your microphone up or even give us a little bit more information in the text chat area. I could say my thought was actually it could be a self-assessment in which, you know, maybe I know journaling was mentioned, that the students are kind of breaking down how the process went for them and what they might be doing differently. Stephanie chimed in with, I asked students to submit evidence of the process along with the final product and submit reflections and self-assessments. Yes, so she was thinking along the same lines. Sometimes it means frequent check-ins or recording videos or drafts. Janet's chiming in with having students reflect on how the process helped them with the final product. Yes, and I think that reflecting and maybe self-assessment is not is finding absolute physical truths as we may normally think in a realist classroom, but I think we absolutely do have our own authentic truths that can be found through a reflection process. And solutions, yes. Definitely, if we do this particular process and we get a C and we do this process differently the next time and we get an A, there's a bit of evidence in that. Lori says, in my field, deadlines are essential. I give credit for meeting specific goals at given times. Those points are separate from the product points. Oh, and that is grading process. Excellent example. I love it when everyone shares these things. We always learn so much from each other. So, thank you. So I am going to kind of wrap things up. I'm in my last few minutes here, and I know that we might be anxious to kind of get up and stretch a little bit. Here are some of the references that I pulled my content from. Very interesting to even explore this. Please use the time before the semester gets too crazy to do your own exploration. And it's been my pleasure to spend some time with you this afternoon. Here is my contact information. If you'd like to just reach out and share philosophy, I'd love to talk to anyone. And of course, you can always reach out to me or any of us in faculty development as you go through the semester and as you kind of explore your teaching philosophy. Thank you.
Thanks, Tracy, so much. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Peter Goen, who is our Online Analytics Coordinator here in Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center at Northern Illinois University. Peter.
Thank you, Janet. Just want to make sure, since I reconnected here, can everyone hear me just fine? Am I a little loud, a little low? Perfect. Okay. Trust you all aren't lying to me. Otherwise, you've got me speaking to you for the next half hour, and I hope to come in just fine. All right. So the topic I'm going to be talking about today is the philosophy of pragmatism and how that influences the classroom. I'm going to be going into a little bit of a different direction than we've seen so far in the first two, idealism and realism. I'll be talking about the philosophy itself, its implication for the classroom, a few examples, and hopefully some of this will resonate with everyone, and you may find these examples useful and implement them into your own practices. This is a more recent philosophy than we've seen so far. Pragmatism was first penned by Charles Sanders Peirce in the late 19th century. It was, in a way, a pushback to earlier philosophers who were more focused on ultimate truths. Instead of pure thought in the pursuit of these ultimate truths, it focuses instead on finding practical solutions to real-world problems, hence pragmatism. So it believes in socially constructed nature of knowledge. It's more focused on the nature of reality that's contextual, that's situated in a particular time and place. Because while we may come up with these grand physical laws, while we may discover 2 plus 2 equals 4, we come up with these logical systems, there's a lot of reality that is shaped through the way that people come together and create knowledge, generate knowledge themselves. John Dewey was a major proponent of pragmatism, and really this is where we get it today and how it's become kind of famous. He saw in pragmatism an emphasis on creating socially aware citizens. If you're trying to educate the next group of professionals, they're people who are going to have to wrestle with big problems. You're not just teaching them skills to do A, X, or Y in certain particular paths or processes. You're also teaching them how to work together, to work on problems where they may not have exact answers or they may be difficult to come up with solutions. But it's because we all come together to generate these realities that we need to focus on, to some extent, creating the next generation of citizens. So what does it mean to be a pragmatist in the classroom? One area in which this philosophy differs from earlier ones is the relationship between teacher and student. Instead of being, again, that one with the ultimate truth at the head of the classroom, a pragmatist teacher is more of a guide amongst peers. For some, this can be a little scary because the pragmatist activities that I've outlined in my presentation here tend to cede some amount of control to your students. You, of course, are still the expert, but you probably see it more as your duty to lend your expertise to train that next generation of professionals. So you'll walk through different kinds of consequential problems. They'll be ambiguous. People may not be able to figure out all the consequences that may arise. It may be difficult to guess at some of them. Students then take part in hands-on activities, and the entire class explores those problems in and around classroom topics, but using everyone's knowledge that they bring with them, some of which you may have already learned in the classroom, some of which they may bring with them because we all share different experiences in life. So I've got a few clues here for whether you may be a pragmatist. So if you believe that knowledge has a certain amount of context dependentness, if there's a certain amount of knowledge that we generate just because everyone sees things from different places or there are different cultures, we all bring different things to the table. If we believe in the interconnectedness of knowledge, again, that we all have these different perspectives and that generating what is known arises from our collective experience. If you don't necessarily believe in disciplinary towers, you know, ivory tower and everyone's in their own tower, that kind of thing. If you believe that the next generation of knowledge, these disciplines are rising and falling based on what we're learning, what we're creating, what we're generating, that whole new disciplines are being created through time. If you see yourself more as a guide for your students, in which case you're creating learning opportunities for them. You're providing opportunities for them to learn more, to generate more knowledge. You may be a pragmatist. If you think that learning is best hands-on, and here you'll notice that there is some overlap with our realism. All these philosophies aren't necessarily cut and dry, and you may feel that you bring certain aspects of these philosophies to the table. Some things may resonate in one and another, so you may count yourself as multiple at the same time. And if you think that students learn from each other, they may learn best from each other, creating that community of inquiry together. If you believe in that wisdom of the crowds effect, that we're all sharing in experiences. We're creating knowledge together. You may be a pragmatist. So I'm curious, at this point, how many people feel like this, at least to some extent, summarizes your own experience? Feel free to raise your digital hand. Yeah, so a number of participants here feel that this echoes at least a certain portion of your own experience. I wonder if you could even quantify that. Do you feel like you're 20% a pragmatist, something like that, 50, 80%? All right. Thank you, everyone. 90%. Jason says he's 90% a pragmatist. Okay. 80%? Cool. Yeah, okay. I've got, if not now, a few converts, hopefully later on. So here I've created a sample pragmatist teaching philosophy. Brian says, depends on the day, and that's a very good point. That's one I wanted to raise here as well. So let me read through this just briefly for our viewer audience at home and who may be listening to this later on. So a sample pragmatist teaching philosophy may read like, as your instructor, I am your guide on the road of learning. I'm not here to fill your head with facts, but to aid you on your journey. I am also not the only one with relevant knowledge. As a class, we will learn by investigating difficult problems and creating solutions together. By doing so, we will build the skills necessary for a professional life in a connected, diverse world. So yes, as Brian says, depending on the day, you may feel yourself more or less one of these other things. You may think that you're mostly one or the other. Tracy asks, is that an absolute percentage? Again, maybe you feel like you're more or less one, depending on the day of the week, depending on the time, depending on how you have just connected with your students or not. Maybe you go into a class and you feel like you are generally pragmatist, but then you learn where your student's coming from and you have to decide maybe this is a little more advanced than where they're at right now. That is another conversation to have and to think about as you're reflecting on your different teaching philosophies here. All right. And Stephanie comments, wants to know how you observe what percentage you are as a pragmatist. That's a good question. So how does everyone decide that they're more or less one of these other ones? Is this gut instinct? Have you tried writing your own teaching philosophies before and you feel that most of it was pragmatist or realist or something like that? Ah, Stephanie says, it was a realist versus pragmatist joke. Very nice. All right. So I'll move on here to a few examples I've picked out, which really bring pragmatism to the fore. These examples are, in a way, in increasing order of complexity, both for you and your students. That's not to say that they're difficult or impossible or anything like that. And as we've seen throughout the Teaching Effectiveness Institute today, there are a wealth of resources amongst our peers here at NIU. If anyone has any questions about implementing these, feel free to contact us, or if there was someone else who raised a particular example, feel free. I mean, absolutely, seek people out. We're all in this together. We're all here for these students. That's why we're here today, absolutely. Okay, so for this first example, here's a group brainstorm activity. So this is a simpler activity that you can implement in your class, which brings together your students in order to kind of generate knowledge amongst all of them. As with most of these activities I'll outline, this is based around classroom activity. And it doesn't necessarily have to be face-to-face, it can be online. I wanted to point out, since we're on here, and we're in here in Blackboard Collaborate today, we're all taking part in this shared experience. You know, we've been generating our own collective knowledge, and we've been doing this all through a web interface. So it isn't necessarily that you have to do this face-to-face. Some people, they may find that that works better for them, and that is perfectly fine. So to work with a group brainstorm, simple activity here, you're trying to get your students to wrestle with particular problems. They're open-ended, they may be ambiguous. There are a couple of different questions that you might think about raising for them. So it could either be a problem your students haven't seen yet. So maybe you're over in the education department, and to get a little meta on us, perhaps you ask them a question around a certain classroom participation issue. You ask your class of ed students, you know, how do you handle a particular issue in your class where the solution isn't necessarily cut and dry? Or maybe it's an issue that's current to your field, that resonates with your field at the moment. It's in the news. It's a hot topic, something that your students might find relevant. Another thing with all these examples here is that they very easily translate to the quote-unquote real world. It's a good way of bringing the real and relevant into the classroom, which sometimes students struggle to see. So for instance, I come originally from the computer science department. One example question I thought might be, how do you solve the issue around self-driving cars? And not to get too grisly, but the trolley problem, if people have heard that before. There's a person on the tracks. Do you swerve not to hit them, but instead you might sacrifice the lives of everyone in your trolley? We're going to have to confront this as a society soon. This is a really big issue, and currently there aren't any good ways of solving it. This would be the kind of problem to pose to the class where it's like, oh yeah, that's really difficult. It probably engages them immediately. Once you've posed this issue to them, you break your class into groups, and you give them a set amount of time to brainstorm. And I see Mandy says, set amount of time, so important. Yes. You want to give them enough time to where they can generate interesting issues and solutions around those issues, not too much time where they're just spending all of it having fun with each other. They need to stay on task, but it can't be so short, obviously, that they don't feel like they've been given enough time to really wrestle with it. Once you've set those time limits, you've set it up, they've broken into their groups, you ask them to identify the issues around this problem. They need to come up with all those different things that might be relevant, might be salient to this particular problem. Who are the stakeholders involved? What are the different problems that they might see around an issue? And also ask them to begin generating the solutions they see and focusing on the consequences that might entail with those different solutions. After they've been given time and they've come up with their lists, you can then bring the classroom back together and discuss this problem. You can have them talk about the different issues they've identified. Which ones are more important, less important? How do people feel about that? Maybe have them vote on it. What are the different solutions they came up with to the problem? What do people feel are the different consequences that may arise from those? Again, the idea behind a lot of this is trying to get them to wrestle with these questions where solutions are hard to come by. We all need to rely on everyone else. They're in a sense, in a very small way, in this classroom setting, building those skills to interact with each other, those social skills to become civic citizens, you know, part of the democratic society. Janet Giesen says, group brainstorm sounds like the beginning of problem-based learning. Yes, and actually this is my third example I want to get to later on. Much larger framework for thinking about pragmatist philosophy in the classroom. Alrighty, so I'm going to move on to my second example here. And this one's a little bit more formal in a way. Second, I see it's taking a little time to load here. Here we go. Good. So yes, class simulations and role plays. And I'm curious who all has heard about these before or used them. If people would raise your hand, you'll notice I included a image here of the Model UN, which a number of NIU students take part of every semester. Yeah, so a number of people have used these before. A lot of people aren't necessarily familiar with it. So I'd like to run through this class simulation role play thing here. This is a stylized form of decision making. Again, it's about bringing those real world experiences into the classroom. And this one is much more formal, usually takes perhaps a class, an entire class period to run through. You come up with a game scenario, in a sense, for your students to work through together. They are actually becoming the people who are going to decide an issue. Often, this isn't necessarily going to be implemented, but it brings that real-world experience from your field to the students. So in this example, I have the model UN, which I highlighted here. Students spend an entire semester learning about the rules and regulations around decision-making at the UN. They learn the different roles of the different people involved in deciding policy, and then it culminates in one big simulation at the end, where they're posed with an issue, it's not easy to resolve, and all these different states are trying to hash things out. So how does one implement this? Perhaps what is a more concrete example here? You want to start by beginning to choose a problem. And this is where you, as the expert in the classroom, really bring your knowledge to bear. So you begin by choosing a problem. And it could be, let's say you are involved in the nonprofit space. You're teaching a public administration class. And you want to talk about decision making around budgetary issues in your nonprofit. You'll identify those different stakeholders involved in a standard, if there is such a one, nonprofit space in a particular organization. The people around might be making some kind of budgetary issue. Maybe they are, in fact, the people in the organization itself. Maybe they're also the people that they're working with. Because not only are the people in the organization deciding it, but if we can think of it in market economic terms for just a second, there's that supply and demand. You're trying to fulfill a certain service to society. And what do you think will be the best for them to do that? So once you've identified those stakeholders, you write down not only the names of all these different stakeholders, but then their different motivations as well. So what does each of them want out of a particular budget? Maybe the marketing people think that they're going to get more buzz if you allocate, you know, 10% more of the budget to marketing. Maybe the people who you're working with think that the way that services were provided could be a little bit different. What are their motivations? What do they think is necessary to arise out of a new budget situation? In doing so, you should see that there's a mix of cooperation and opposition amongst the different stakeholders. Or else, of course, it's a fairly trivial decision-making process, and you'll want to revisit a different problem. Another way of doing this, if you're in political science, I actually took one course where we went through a decision-making scenario around War and Peace. We had been studying decision-making at the state level. And we thought, okay, you know, who are the different stakeholders involved in if we ended up going to war? So there's the president, and there are different political parties, there are the different people in Congress or the military. Identifying those stakeholders and their motivations around here is very important. Once you've created all of those and written the stakeholders and their motivations down on, say, 3x5 index cards, something like that, bring those to class, and then pose the scenario to the class. So here's what you're doing today. You're going to be broken down into however many groups you may have. If it's a small class, maybe it's just one group. Maybe it's just that nonprofit, and they're deciding this budget. If it's a larger group of students, perhaps you divide them into multiple groups. So in our class, we had enough people for, say, two states to decide whether we're going to duke it out. So break the class into groups if necessary, pose the scenario to them, and then have them draw their different roles from a hat. So now they're given this problem to solve. They know whose hat they're wearing and what their different motivations are for deciding this policy. And then you'll give them a short amount of time or a larger amount of time, depending on how you feel is necessary to decide steps along the way, and then have them make those different decisions along the way, if necessary. Maybe it's the beginning of tension between our different societies. And right now, we're just deciding how to posture or not. We may not be. We may not have gotten to the point where war seems inevitable. You know, maybe we can resolve things peacefully so far. As you're going through it, you'll just have different sections in the class where you give your class a certain set of time. You decide how much time to give them, have them get to that, and make a decision by a particular point. You can time them, you know, have them look at the clock in the classroom if there is one, and by that point, have them make whatever decision is necessary to advance your particular scenario. And then follow up with subsequent positions until you get to your final one at the end. So for those people who use simulations or roller, I'm curious what scenarios you've come up with. Because these can be really fun, really relevant for the classroom. And I've always loved them myself. I've done a couple at conferences before, and I did one in one class before. So what are the ones that you've either used in your class or experienced? Feel free to type in the text chat, or if you'd like, you can just go ahead and annotate on my slide. I don't mind. Stephanie says, as a much smaller activity, I have students simulate an evaluation by evaluating the quality of chocolate chip cookies. That's interesting. Tracy did a debate on pro or against extended video game time with fifth graders. I'm curious how that one turned out.
Alrighty. Hey, Peter, I'll tell you yes. How it turned out. So we did it twice. And in one instance, the pro group won the debate, and in another instance, the against group won. So it was just, I think it was a product of who the stronger debater group was, but I was amazed that I actually had so many fifth graders pushing against extended video game time.
That's fascinating, yes. Obviously, for the statistically inclined, an N of 2 may not necessarily be representative of fifth graders, but yeah, that they would come down to 50-50 between a couple of times you ran that. Very interesting. Okay. These are great responses. Mandy says, students last semester designed and ran a linguistics study. Class broken into 5 groups for different research study tasks. Yes, and again, as I'll get to in my next example, the larger framework for problem-based learning. Marcia says, how to moderate a parent-teacher meeting on sexuality education. Ooh, I bet that one must have been very interesting. Yes, Stephanie Ur says, healthcare topic debate. Very cool. And Brian says, class as tech consultants, trying to collectively determine how to handle a difficult ethical IT situation. So you'll see there's a range of different topics here, different fields that are involved with this kind of thing. It's a scenario. Simulations and role plays are useful in any field. We have a mix of STEM. We have a mix of humanities. All of our fields are embedded in society. We can't escape that. No matter how much we might want to at times, we might want to just say, no, this is how it is. We're going to do it this way. Because we are a group of citizens, and this is a democratic country, and we believe in all that great stuff, we have to wrestle with difficult situations at times. Okay. So for my final example here, I want to talk about this larger framework of problem-based learning. And you'll notice elements of this that arose in my earlier examples. So what is problem-based learning? It's an instructional approach where students learn by solving challenging open-ended problems. So already we begin to see all these different elements from pragmatism entering. The problems are supposed to be authentic, and they're solved in groups. They're solved through socially and contextually relevant teamwork. The students rely on both their current knowledge of the problems and identify, critically here, the knowledge that they don't have. So you assign or you can generate, maybe through a group brainstorm, different problems that the different groups may solve. You then have these groups take their problem and analyze it. They find out what information do they already know. What information do other people know? What solutions have other people come up with? Then once they've begun to gather all of these different ideas, all of this information, you have them generate their own solutions and then test and refine those solutions. And you'll notice the final step, as this kind of completes the entire circle here, this process, no matter where people ultimately end, even if they have a great solution to a problem, that doesn't mean it's necessarily perfect in all instances. So for instance, this may be an engineering capstone. When we're talking about problem-based learning, it's usually a bit larger of an activity. It may span a few weeks. You're trying something experiential in your class. This could be an entire semester or a year's capstone project. So if this were in engineering, maybe the first semester you have them going through and generating solutions. It's mostly the research phase, and they're trying to figure out what's already been done, what is new that they know about materials or processes, manufacturing, that might let them create a better version of an existing solution. And then in the second semester, follow up with that and begin actually creating those, working with materials, figuring out the different manufacturing processes, et cetera, and then presenting that at the end. All right. I noticed I've got just a few minutes left, so let me move on here. I would be happy to talk to people about any of these examples. And Janet here is an expert on problem-based learning, so I would love also to get her involved if you are interested. She says, it would be neat for student groups work with other student groups when working on a problem, gathering information from each other rather than from the teacher. Good point. Again, this collective wisdom, this shared knowledge, so important. All right. So to wrap things up really quickly, for those who said that they were pragmatists, or for those who have been newly inspired, I wanted to get some examples from the audience. And here I've just embedded a word cloud on my slide of some words and phrases that may help spur some ideas. So what are some other things that people here at the university are doing that they feel is pragmatic on campus? That's really bringing those experiences, those social skills to the classroom. Stephanie follows up with, faculty development regularly offers a workshop on problem-based or experiential learning, which offers a deeper discussion of, as we call it, PBL. And so look for that in the future. So what are some other things that people are doing here? We already mentioned a few examples from a few different fields around different simulations or role play. And I'll open up my slide again. If anyone wants to draw on it, please go ahead and feel free to do so. That's why I've already cluttered it up with a word cloud to get everyone started. I have people circling things, interdisciplinary work. So what kind of interdisciplinary work do you have your students doing in your classes? I can also cede the microphone if anyone would like to talk. Stephanie says they choose a real-world program to work with. So, in addition to evaluating those cookies, I have my students in the evaluation course actually design an evaluation from identifying a program through creating evaluation metrics. Aha. Tracy says, I like social science with science. Indeed. Tracy says, NIU hosted its first hackathon. Yes, that's right, last September, which epitomizes this whole learning style. Yes, it's getting those students involved in problems in society. Absolutely. Allison says, we invite a group of related health professionals to class to hold a brainstorm session where students come up with ways to build collaborations with other professionals. That's excellent. Alicia says, I have found that when students work like this in a group, it helps boost confidence when they realize they do have knowledge. Yes, that is a major point of pragmatism. People aren't just inexpert when they're coming to all these things, especially when we're talking about these sorts of problems. People have opinions. They have some idea on this. It's a great way. You might think that this is more for your more advanced students, but a lot of them already have some of that relevant knowledge. And they may find that involving them in these discussions early on, since you're helping them feel like real professionals or adults, it gives them that confidence boost. Brian says, community project to learn about project management. Andy says, students work together to come up with topic for in-depth investigation. Collective, group, hands-on, awesome. Yes, part of the hack, yes. Helping students realize that they are working with the constituents. That's great. Again, connecting the community to the students, building that social space. Alrighty. And I see it is already 3:30. So let me go ahead and wrap up here. Thank you all for your participation. Thank you also for having me here to present on pragmatism for you. I hope this has been useful for everyone. I would love to continue this discussion later on. If you have any questions around anything I presented today, I would love to go over it with you. This stuff is so much fun. It's really where I'm coming from, too. So I've got a few references here. We'll follow up with these slides later on. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you, Peter. Well, we have one more presentation. And now I would like to introduce Yvonne Johnson, who is the Multimodal Coordinator here in Faculty Development and Instructional Design Center at Northern Illinois University. Yvonne.
Thank you, Janet. As Janet said, I am the Multimodal Teaching Coordinator in Faculty Development. And during my presentation, we will be talking about a few key concepts of existentialism as a philosophical perspective. We will also connect the philosophy with the practice of education. A couple of key concepts related to existentialism are the individual is considered as an entity within the larger social context, and there is a significant focus on freedom from the existentialist perspective. Kierkegaard was a Danish philosopher who is often known as the father of existentialism. In terms of existentialism, freedom takes place within a particular context. The world is part of the context. A person's past, their characteristics, and circumstances all influence their freedom. And their freedom is impacted by judgments of others, which came up in Dr. Laura Vasquez's discussion this morning when she was talking about films that her students produce. Existentialism also focuses on aspects of society that impact freedom, such as economic and political conditions that impact freedom. Critical theory is something that is, and critical pedagogy, which Dr. Carrie Birch mentioned earlier, are also connected with existentialism. Now, these are very complex topics, so we're just kind of touching the surface, as my other colleagues have said. A brief description of critical theory is it's a philosophical approach to culture that seeks to confront social, historical, and ideological forces and structures that produce and constrain it. And critical pedagogy, which we'll talk about at the end of the session, is a related educational philosophy that focuses on analysis of world events, controversial issues, and diversity to provide a vision of a better world and social change. When we're talking about individuals in terms of existentialism, the uniqueness of individuals is valued. And one of the earlier presenters talked about, it was discussed in the morning session, reality as being subjective, and it lies within the individual, and that's an existentialist perspective. And the development of the authentic individual is also important. Educators with an existential focus are opposed to thinking about students as objects. They think about students as individuals and value the individual, which we also talked about in the discussion this morning. And in terms of authenticity, from the existential perspective, the degree to which an individual stays true to their own morals, values, and character is important in terms of how they're reacting to external pressures. And as I go through the presentation, we'll talk about ways to incorporate these concepts into the classroom. When existentialists consider freedom, they look at individuals and their ability to shape their learning and their experiences. As you can see at the top of the slide, individual choice and standards are central to the existential perspective. Students are encouraged to take responsibility for their actions, and we'll talk about how students can do that. And you'll see a picture on the slide that is one of our former graduate students. He graduated in December, and we're very proud of him. So I was very happy that I could incorporate a picture of him on our slide in terms of existentialism. We wish Saram well in his journey in his new job. In the existentialist classroom, students are encouraged to take responsibility for their actions. And they're encouraged to work with the professor to shape their learning. And we'll talk about how you can do that in the classroom in a few minutes. This morning, Dr. Carrie Birch mentioned Paulo Freire's theory, and he talked about the banking philosophy. And the banking philosophy, in Freire's perspective, was where instructors would deposit information into students' brains, and students would withdraw those deposits for assessment purposes. So the existentialists would say that they want the students to shape their learning experiences rather than just withdraw information that the professors had shared with them. To provide an example, I drafted a sample existential teaching philosophy. So I'll just read it so that it's on the recording for the people who may be listening and watching this later, and then we'll break it down. As a professor, I value the unique perspectives of individual learners. Students are provided options to demonstrate their learning in ways that are meaningful to them. My courses are designed to facilitate development of individual students within the larger context of the learning community. Critical pedagogy is used to analyze complex issues to support social change. So you can see that there's a lot packed into that existential sample teaching philosophy. And someone earlier had asked about sample teaching philosophies, so here is another example for you. So let's break that down a little bit. I value the unique perspectives of individual learners. So how might that play out in the classroom? In class discussions, students would be encouraged to share various viewpoints and respectfully share different opinions and engage in meaningful conversations and discourse. And there's not one correct answer. So the second part, students are provided options to demonstrate their learning in ways that are meaningful to them. So as a faculty member, we can allow students different options for meeting the course objectives rather than only requiring all students to complete exactly the same assignments. The instructor might provide a list of assignment options from which the students could choose to meet the course requirements. And we can talk about that a little bit as we move into the presentation a little bit more. The courses are designed to facilitate development of individual students within the larger context of the learning community. So I teach a research proposal development course for the Department of Educational Technology Research and Assessments. And my students come from a wide variety of backgrounds. So when I work with them, I encourage them to share their various perspectives throughout the entire course, share their reflections, and I encourage them to work with other students in the community so that the students as individuals grow and the learning community grows as well. And we will also talk about that as an example in a few minutes. And then critical pedagogy is used to analyze complex issues. So critical pedagogy can be incorporated in a variety of different ways. But even on the simplest level, you can incorporate readings from different perspectives to show critical analysis of different perspectives related to the subject matter of your course. And that would be one way that you could incorporate critical pedagogy into a course. And we'll talk about a couple of other ways in a few minutes. When we're considering existentialism in practice, it's important for the learning experiences to be genuine for the students. And several of the other presenters have talked about that. And there's a picture there that shows, you know, a genuine learning experience for students exploring some kind of science. It's also important for students to have opportunities for self-direction and self-actualization. And we'll talk about some of those examples, and some of my colleagues have shared some examples, but we'll look at different options in a couple of minutes. Some of the samples that we'll talk about may be appropriate for the course and context that you teach in, and some of them may not. But the decision for applying the examples would be under the purview of the faculty. So the three examples that I'm going to talk about are learning contracts, learning communities, and critical pedagogy. So has anyone that's in the session now actually used a learning contract in their class? If you could raise your hands, please, if you've used a learning contract in your class. Okay, awesome. Okay, Peter, thank you. Okay, so it looks like learning contract is kind of a new concept for people, and that's great. A learning contract is a formal agreement between a learner and a faculty member, and it specifies what will be learned, how it will be learned, what will be produced as evidence to show that the student learned, and what types of assessments will be used. When you use a learning contract in a course, it is very important to first explain the process to the students so that they understand that, since it's a new concept to most of the people in this particular session, it's probably a new contract to a lot of students as well. So it's important to explain to the students why you would be using this type of process in your course and why it's beneficial. Thank you, Stephanie, for sharing that resource. So learning contracts provide students the opportunity to have input related to their learning experiences for the course. And that connects with the idea of genuine and authentic learning experiences for students. And that's a very existential perspective. When the learning contracts are developed, students are partners in the development of their learning goals in conjunction with the faculty member. So the faculty member, it begins this process by explaining the concept to the students. They talk about what will be learned. Well, that's connected with the course objectives. So if you connect that, that will make sense to the students. How it will be learned, that's connected with the course activities. What will be produced is connected with the types of assignments that they'll submit. And then how the learning will be assessed would be, how would they be graded? So we'll talk a little bit about the process. There's some important issues to keep in mind if you're considering using a learning contract in your course. And some of the aspects of the learning contract would be non-negotiable. The learning contract needs to be appropriate for the level of the course. So it has to have the appropriate level of rigor, has to be connected with the content of the course. The outcomes and the process have to be appropriate for the size and scope of the contract, the subject of the course. If it's an undergraduate contract, it's going to be different than a graduate level contract. And obviously it needs to be connected with the learning objectives of the course. For a learning contract, the objectives are written by the student, but they're connected with the course objectives that the faculty member created when they were designing the course. The faculty member approves the contract, and the faculty member evaluates the product, the final product. So you can see that there are a number of similarities. The faculty member still guides the process and grades. And as a graduate student in the College of Education, I completed a course where we used a learning contract for our course final project. And I have to say, it was a very interesting learning experience, and the process of developing the contract was as valuable as the actual learning outcomes that we produced and agreed to as part of the contract. It was a really interesting process, and I still think about it today, and grad school was a number of years ago. So let's look at a sample of a learning contract. So this example comes from the work of Malcolm Knowles. He is a leading adult educator, and he has produced quite a bit of work related to learning contracts. So you can see what we talked about earlier, the what the students are going to learn is part of this matrix. How they're going to learn it, the dates, and you have the dates obviously would have to be within the semester that you're teaching, how they're going to learn it, and how they're going to be assessed. So this kind of gives you an example of what a learning contract might look like. And you can see that under the how, it says regularly participating in synchronous and asynchronous discussions, objectively reviewing classmates' work. There's connections with theories. There are, you know, it specifies four different theories. So you can see there's different standards that have to be met. And there is actually extensive work on learning contracts. And it's something that might be appropriate for some classes, but not for others. But it was a very good learning opportunity for us in our graduate level education courses. Some of the benefits of learning contracts connect with what a number of my colleagues and those speaking this morning talked about. There's increased learner motivation because the students see that they are partners in the process. They've selected a topic and activities that are important to them. They have a sense of ownership because the instructor did not assign them something that they had to complete. The students developed it in conjunction with the course objectives and the instructor. So it's focused on learner interest and course-related goals. So the students tend to be more motivated and engaged, and the discussions in the class are much more engaging than if everyone is talking about something that they weren't really interested in. Okay, so now we're going to talk about another concept that relates to existential philosophy. Learning communities. We hear a lot about learning communities. There's discussions about professional learning communities, personal learning communities in the classroom. So I'm going to focus on learning communities in the classroom for the purpose of this particular discussion. Again, just to kind of get an idea of where people are coming from, has anyone tried to work with building a learning community in their classroom? Just a show of hands. Okay, Stephanie, thank you. Okay, so we had a couple of people that have worked on developing learning communities in their classrooms. And a learning community treats the classroom as a locus of community building. So you interact with the students in different ways, and I'll talk to you about some techniques that you could use to develop learning communities in the classrooms. Learning communities also include cooperative learning techniques, and they use group process learning activities. So let me talk about a few examples of techniques that you could use when you're trying to build a learning community. So on the first day of class, we all have activities that we engage in on the first day of class. One thing that you can do to build a learning community is use an icebreaker type of activity and have the students get up, combine the introductions, and use it as an icebreaker and develop a set of questions that connect with course materials and then provide students the opportunity to share something about themselves. So what I do in my classes is I have students physically get up, I give them a piece of paper that has a set of prompts that they're to respond to, and so that they know that they have some kind of a guide. They answer these prompts, and one of the things I do to build the community is that when I have students introduce themselves, I don't have them introduce themselves, I have them introduce someone else. So I'll put people in pairs and have them fill out the sheet of questions for the other person, and they have to introduce the other person. And so they develop greater connections with each other, they learn more about each other, and they kind of start off on a stronger footing for engaging with each other. They find out commonalities that they have. Another way that you can build activity, you can build learning communities, is that you can continue to mix students up in the class. So have them work with different people in different groups throughout the class, if that fits with your classroom dynamic. But it helps people to connect with everyone in the class, as opposed to just working with the same people all the time. One of the things I also do is, since I teach a research proposal development course, I have them, the first day of class, start considering their research topics. And they start to share insights with each other about those topics, and they start to connect, and they see that people in the classroom are experts in fields that can help them. So it really builds those connections. As an instructor, you can also use audio and video feedback and provide opportunities for students to use audio and video in the classroom, and that helps you to build a stronger community. There's a sense of presence, connections, and engagement among the people in the classroom. And another thing that I do regularly is use reflection activities, and it helps people see why the activity was important, the connections to themselves, then they share that with their colleagues in the course, and they reflect and share insights with each other based upon their initial responses. And then as the semester continues, they become more proficient at that, and their connections build, and they become stronger. So those are a few ways that you can use, techniques that you can use to build community in the classroom. How many people are familiar on some level with critical pedagogy? Raise your hand. Okay, so thank you. Thank you. Okay, so we have a number of people who are familiar with critical pedagogy, and you will know that you will see that this is a very concise description of critical pedagogy. But even though it's concise, it's packed with quite a bit of information. You can see that critical pedagogy goes beneath the surface. We look at root causes of issues, not just the superficial what you see. We dig deeper. There's a thorough analysis and deconstruction of social issues, and considers personal consequences from a critical perspective. So we'll talk a little bit about how you might incorporate critical pedagogy in your courses. Often when we talk about critical pedagogy, discourse is a term that comes up, and I was thinking of examples that have emerged in my courses, and one of the things that came up in a prior semester was, as I said, I teach a research proposal development course, and okay, Brian Bender says he did that and it was great. Thanks, Brian. So I teach a research proposal development course, and we were talking about literature reviews. And in this discussion, The students in this particular cohort were very new to research, and in the discussion of literature reviews, one of the students said, "Well, Dr. Johnson, you know, it would be really easy for me just to present a bunch of literature that supports one perspective. Couldn't I do that in my literature review?" And so, you know, I thought to myself, okay, this is an outstanding example of a time that we can, you know, it's a teachable moment. So we started a discourse on this topic. We discussed what might happen if you only presented one side of an issue. And a number of these students worked in school districts. So he said, okay, so what happens if you present only one side of the issue to a school board when you're maybe asking for a referendum to be passed? What happens if some of those people on the school board have knowledge about different perspectives? They know about the other literature that you didn't present to them. And the students' wheels started turning and they started thinking and they said, oh, okay, that makes sense. I never thought about that. And we talked about the ethics so it's a great teachable moment. And then another situation with a different cohort connects with this social consciousness and critical analysis of society. This particular student was researching school district consolidations. And he wanted to just look at the financial aspects. But then after we got done with the literature review process, he said, you know what, I want to ask you if I can change my topic and focus more on the personal community aspects than the financial aspects. So he started to deconstruct those structures and look at, okay, if we have a referendum, how is this going to impact the society, the community, things like that, the people. So that was a really neat teachable moment as well. So as I said, critical pedagogy is a complex topic, and I wanted to give the people in the session a moment to be able to write on the whiteboard and talk about how you may incorporate existential concepts into your classes. So if you want to write on there, how might you incorporate or promote student choice? We talked about learning contracts. We talked about different options for assignments. How might you promote student responsibility or social consciousness in your classes? So if you could type on the whiteboard and provide some examples of how you might promote student choice, student responsibility, or social consciousness, that'd be great. Okay, so community projects, yes, that's a great example. Thank you. Mm-hmm. What about student responsibility or student choice? Choice of topics discussed throughout the semester? Okay, excellent, yes. Okay, so those are good examples of how you might incorporate, okay, select from a list of topics, yes, okay. So it seems like a number of people do allow students to provide, to select from different topics, okay, present current events, yep, that's excellent. Students moderating gives them responsibility, yes, that's a great example. Have students reflect, yes, we talked about that in terms of existentialism. That's great. Okay, so the examples connect very well with existential teaching philosophies, and we're getting near the end of the day here. I want to thank each of you for your participation and your engagement, and I am going to ask, are there any questions? Oh, great. Okay, glad to help, Brian. That's great. Okay, does anyone have any questions before we move to Janet Giesen? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Yvonne.
You're welcome.
All right, everyone. It's been a really full day, but I have a few concluding remarks. And we definitely talk, and then I'll end it with showing you the URL, and we'll get you out of here probably within the next 10 minutes or so. So what I'd like you to do is take some time to think deeply and reflect about why you teach, why you do what you do, and how you do what you do. Think about all the parts of your teaching and reflect on the possible educational philosophies that were presented today that resonate with the ways that you teach. Then think about connecting and realigning the doing parts of your teaching. Those are the methods, the strategies, the activities. Aligning those with your teaching philosophy, or whatever you might want to call it, maybe your vision for teaching. The revising part can come at any part in your teaching, and really should come throughout your teaching. But as you connect the teaching philosophy that you have with your teaching practices, some revision will most likely occur. All of these steps can lead to you and your teaching being more credible and more authentic, and allow you to be a more creative, philosophical teacher. And as our presenters have shown us, teaching philosophies really aren't cookie-cutter replicas, but rather unique to each of us, and our approach to teaching, and our approach to students, and where we want our students to be at the end of the semester. You should now realize that you can utilize these isms wholly or by selecting just parts of them. But once your philosophy has been completed, do plan to share them with your students. Put it in your course syllabus, on your Blackboard courses, your personal websites, and share it with your colleagues. Keep it close to where you do your course preparation, your desk at home, maybe in your office, and where you do your grading. And I would use it as a motivational statement that you can refer to throughout the semester. So go ahead and draft or modify your teaching philosophy, and then see where it takes you. Stephanie.
Thanks, Janet. I wanted to take a quick moment to go back to our activity from this morning. So for those of you who are here, when we went through our guided reflection, we had these series of prompts, and I wanted to sort of raise the curtain for a second and first of all go back and look at these, but then also point out that these were specifically chosen prompts. So on each of these, as we went through it, these each corresponded to one of the philosophies we talked about this afternoon. So I'm going to add here what those were next to each of them, and they were in the same order each time. So if you found yourself selecting the first quadrant, that was idealism. The upper left, I should say. The right upper quadrant were realism, the lower left is pragmatism, and the lower right is existentialism. So I could almost put together a like a magazine style quiz or an online test. See which educational philosophy you believe in based on these prompts. But I do encourage you to go back. That means that on your template, they were in order 1, 2, 3, 4 in a list. So if you responded with a lot of ones or a lot of twos or threes or fours, you can kind of get a sense of which philosophy it might be that you are most connected to as of now. And I have to say, it seemed like in our presentations this afternoon, everyone was about as, I hate to say indecisive, that sounds negative, but we're as much of a mixing pot, a melting pot of philosophies this afternoon, I think, as you were this morning. But for example, this slide on I believe students learn best by, we clearly had strong pragmatist leanings, I think. If we go to the role of the teacher, I think here we had slightly more idealist views or existentialist views, honestly, of being the role model and the shepherd. And then for the question on what you wanted students to learn, I think here we showed just a broad dedication to wanting students to learn everything and wanting to support them as a holistic student. which tends to be more of an idealist or pragmatist or an existential view than a realism, potentially. But we saw how they all interconnected and related. And then finally, on student benefits, again, we were, as a group, tended more towards pragmatist and existentialist beliefs. So keep that in mind. Go back and look at the prompts from this morning. And if you weren't in the morning session, we will send you the list of questions that we asked with our follow-up email from the afternoon so that you can ask yourself these questions and consider for yourself which of the four philosophies it is that you actually tend to align with as you continue to reflect and revise and perhaps write a formal teaching philosophy statement. So I'm going to pass things back over now to Janet. I'll get your slide back up. There you go, Janet.
Thank you, Stephanie. That was a nice kind of recap of what we had done earlier today. So we want to thank you for you participating in today's institute. We would like you to reach out to faculty development for any of your teaching needs and resources that we have. We will push out the evaluation link right after this particular slide. We'll be sending you certificates of participation in a follow-up and a follow-up email with information, as Stephanie said, on how to access the archives of today's presentations. I'd like to thank my faculty development colleagues, Cameron, Dan, Peter, Stephanie, Tracy, Yvonne, for the many hours we spent planning, designing, and developing today's programs. You wouldn't believe how much time we do spend on making these things successful. And also our behind-the-scenes colleagues, Brandy and Jason, for their assistance as well. Finally, though, we do need to thank you, our participants, for your interest in participating in these types of institutes. Your presence is critical. Without your presence, these types of programs really would not be as successful as they are. So we sincerely hope that you enjoyed today's institute, the morning and the afternoon session. We'd love to hear from you about your progress with the teaching philosophy. Any of us can help you with that, or we'd love just to read them, give you some feedback. We also encourage you to visit our website for various resources and consider registering for some of the remaining January workshops that are coming up and then also our February workshops that are coming up. So we look forward to seeing you in any of our programs that we offer through faculty development throughout the spring semester. So if you're traveling today, travel safely, get home safe, and have a great spring semester. And thank you again for participating in the Spring 2016 Teaching Effectiveness Institute. Bye-bye, everybody.